Illinois claims a dubious distinction. It hosts great numbers of Chicago's dearly departed and plentiful cemeteries. Among historical graveside sprawls, Showman's Rest in Woodlawn Cemetery. It's haunted by the restless spirit of Leora LaValle. Five elephant statues, trunks draped downward in postures of bereavement, loom, silent sentinels. They mark the site of a mass grave. Approximately 60 circus performers and roustabouts were laid to rest after a catastrophic train wreck. Bareback riders, aerialists, elephant trainers, clowns, ballerinas, all employees of the Hayden Beck Wallace Circus. That mass grave proved a grim necessity. Circus performers tragically burned beyond recognition. Others were itinerant workers hired a few days earlier. No one was certain of their given names. Smiley, Baldy, and unidentified female number 45 perished among them. Sadly, rescue workers never recovered many of the bodies. News articles published at the time presumed that victims incinerated during the devastating wreck. All met a ghastly demise on June 22, 1918. Just before 4 o'clock that morning, Leora and Deborah LaValle dozed in a folding room. They raved swinging stars at the circus. Raven-haired and limbered, the defiant twins performed a daring aerial act. Without Annette. Beneath the tent, the dazzling duo flipped, dropped, and clung by painted toes on a double trapeze. Before mesmerized crowds, the twins caught each other by the wrists and dangled above the ring. Leora! Deborah! Exuberant audiences hurrahed. They stomped their boots until pine stands wobbled and groaned. Once, and only once, the trapeze twins endured a narrow escape. Deborah stumbled on a sky-high platform. The audience gasped in collective terror as she plunged toward the ring. With lightning-quick reflexes, Leora grasped her twin's ponytail and yanked her to safety. It was so peculiar, so very bizarre, Leora insisted after that dreadful fright. She experienced a strange sense of doom that day. Her stomach sloshed like a bucket of slops, and she begged her twin to cancel the show. But Deborah poo-pooed the premonition. The show must go on, she said. She fluffed plumes on her ruby headpiece and tilted it at a jaunty angle. But, oh you and your creepy crawlies. Always fussing and fretting, Deborah said. Told you so, Leora said afterwards. I'm as talented at prophecy as the bearded lady is at sprouting goatees. Leora playfully tugged Deborah's ponytail. Deborah winced, her scalp still smarting, and Leora's feeble joke fell flat, as if she'd missed the trapeze bar. Now, in a double berth, the twins slept peacefully. Against pillows, curls framed matching faces in dark halos. Leora, 4 minutes older, and Deborah's tried and true protector, awoke with a jolt. She lifted her head, disoriented. Apprehension snatched her by the waist. It mercilessly squeezed. Panic suffocated her like a damp pillow over the mouth. Deborah would taunt her. Their argument was always the same. Pshaw on your creepy crawlies! Snicker if you must. Who was right when she divined Papa wouldn't return from the endless war? You were correct, of course. And when the creepy crawlies ciphered Mama wouldn't recover from the consumption, You. And again, who proved prescient, insisting we leap from the orphan train and strike out on our own? You were right. Deborah chucked her sister under the chin. Smile for once. Now, why not induce those creepy crawlies of yours to bring us grand acclaim and handsome beau, eh? Must you perpetually usher in gloom and doom? I can't control the creepy crawlies. They possess a will of their own, and they intrude on my thoughts, unknown. The train stopped on a track near Ivanhoe, Indiana. In four wooden coaches, 400 circus performers slept en route to heaven. Terror covered her scalp. She hyperventilated in frantic puffs. She reached across Devorah's pillow to tug urgently at her sister's curls. At that very instant, a vacant troop train thundered along the tracks. Racing to Chicago from Kalamazoo, it barreled towards the circus train. Ill-fated engineer Alonzo Sargent, weary from lack of sleep and lulled into a stupor by a dose of kidney pills, dozed at the throttle. His troop train slammed into the rear of the circus train like a battering ram. An ear-splitting din of metal obliterating wood roused the town with a death knell. The troop train devoured three of the circus train's cars. It chomped them like carrots before awakening Sargent with a horrific racket. Sargent finally halted the train atop the fourth circus car. Fate, merciless, was not content to stop with it. Inside the demolished circus train, kerosene lamps ignited. Wooden cars provided endless fuel for the gluttonous fire. It raged for hours as hollow-eyed townsfolk gathered. Devorah died as she slept, crushed when the cars telescoped. Leora, nightgown splayed out behind her like a pink phantom, cannonballed from the wreckage. Jeb Crawley, a divinity student who lived in a cold water walkout near the tracks, tore to the scene. He found Leora crumpled near twisted ruins, and he covered her with his ratty woolen overcoat. Eyes crazed in a swollen face, she groaned, "Might, man." Leora felt entombed in cement. She panted, "Can't move." Jeb crouched beside her and murmured a prayer in her mangled ear. He squared his broad shoulders to block her view of the inferno and staunched her blood with a tattered handkerchief. Leora gradually recovered from broken limbs and internal injuries. That was the easy part. She never returned to her glorious trapeze act, though. And those creepy Crawleys never ushered in a handsome beau. Instead, Leora grew dour, solitary. Something inside her tattered and turned to pulp, like a paper doll in a rain puddle. She endlessly replayed a silent mental film. In stark black and white, slim fingers crept towards Devorah's curls and birth. In the random ways of life and death and fiery tragedies, those who are spared and those who perish remain the luck of a cosmic draw. But Leora raged at fools who philosophized. A Vesuvius of guilt, she spewed rebuke. It was my fault. I wasn't quick enough. In time, the wreck claimed another victim. Leora Lavalle succumbed to a broken heart. In her final moments, she asked for her twin, and she gripped a nurse's knobby shoulder in a surprisingly forceful hold, the kind of hold she once used to latch onto Devorah's arms as they held sway over breathless crowds. Leora commends herself to this day. As dawn breaks over Shannon's Rest, a nimble woman with disheveled curls and wild eyes roams among grave sites near those mortal elephant statues. "Devorah, where are you?" Feral yowls deliver a twitchy terror. The lost soul wanders among grave markers, seizes an elephant's foot, and flips onto the creature's back. Woeful keening howlings like a cryptic wind. It resounds among slanted tombstones in the boneyard. And then Leora fades away, like fog over Lake Michigan. Not too enthralled, huzzah!